Good morning, everyone. We welcome all parishioners and visitors as we prepare to celebrate the fourth Sunday of Advent. There are a few announcements. We will resume printing a few bulletins next weekend for those who do not have computer access. Those who have been receiving Father Rico's update via email will continue to receive the bulletin electronically. If you have not reserved your seat online for one of the Christmas Masses, please do so soon as possible, as there are a few seats left with our spacing and 30% limited. Our celebrant today is Father Rico. Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
As we begin our fourth week of Advent, we light our fourth Advent candle. And we continue our Advent prayer. Come, Lord Jesus. At this Mass, we pray in a special way for the repose of the soul of Olga Grizzuti and a special intention for Dave and Patty McClung. For the times we fail to be like Mary, opening our hearts to the will of God in our lives, we bow our heads and ask for God's mercy, for he is full of gentleness and compassion.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech you, O Lord, your grace into our hearts, that we, to whom the incarnation of Christ your Son was made known by the message of an angel, may by his passion and cross be brought to the glory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. Now, when David the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went. And I have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly, from the time I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you, David, that the Lord will make you a house. And when your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne, David, shall be established forever." The word of the Lord. Reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, to the one who was able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about obedience of faith to the only wise God through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be done according to your word.
Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you.
The gospel be on my mind, on my lips, and in my heart.
The angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing is impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Well, my friends, as I was preparing my homily for today, my wife said to me, "Have you finished your homily?" I said, "No." I said, "I'm just really getting into it." And she said, "Which gospel are you preaching about this weekend?" And I said, "Well, it's when the angel appears to Mary and tells her that she's going to have a child, Jesus." "Oh," she said, "that's good." I said to her, "Well, do you have any suggestions, something that I could use?" She said, "Yes, keep it short." You know, I was at Scapular a while back, and just before Mass started, this lady came up to me and she said, "Are you preaching today?" And I said, "Yes." She went, "Am I missing something here?" Last night after my homily, after Mass was over, a lady came up to me and she said, "My father has been in public speaking for a long time." And she said, "He always told her that it's harder to preach a short sermon than it is a long one. It's harder to come up with a short one." I guess because, you know, sometimes we like to take a little bit of time and explain. And I'll tell you why we do this. I really believe in my heart that we as preachers and homilists feel it so deeply, the words that we read, the words that are in our hearts, how much it means to us and how God impresses on us these special feelings that we have. And I know that as ministers, as preachers, we like to impart that onto our people, onto the congregation, because we want you to feel the same way. We want you to take away from these gospel readings and the other readings what we take away, how we feel about it. Sometimes we're in awe of these words and the feelings that God gives us, He implants in us, and we only want you to feel the same way.
That's why sometimes we might go overboard a little bit. It's only because we see something important, and we want you to see something important too. And it hurts sometimes, you know, when we give a message and find that maybe the people just aren't getting it. We want you to get it. We want you to be able to speak about it after Mass to your friends. We want you to understand what exactly is going on in these words. We want you to feel the same feelings that we feel. That's why sometimes we might go over a little bit. It's only because we think it's so important. And God knows that it's important. So I'm going to say to you today, Happy Fourth Sunday in Advent. Or perhaps I should say to you, Merry Christmas. For actually, if you really think about it, Christmas really begins with today's gospel. Because we have in front of us our beautiful angel Gabriel coming to Mary and announcing the most wonderful thing that will ever happen, the incarnation, the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Without this, we really have nothing. And you know, there has never, ever been better good news proclaimed than what the angel Gabriel spoke to Mary on that day. Because of sin, the world was out of control and had not had paid attention to what God really wanted for them. Then, out of nowhere, comes an angel to a young girl from a lowly family in a nowhere land to announce the greatest news ever heard by human ears. Just think about it for a moment. Mary, a young girl, some say 13, 14, 15, 16. What was on her mind in those days? Well, she was engaged to be married. So she was probably thinking where she was going to have the service, who was going to be there, what kind of food they were going to have, is it going to be a good day, is everything going to go all right? And then the angel comes in and stops everything. As an angel speaks to Mary and tells her that she has found favor with God and that she will conceive and bear a son who will change and rule the world. She became very much perplexed, I can imagine, by those angels' words, and even pondered them in her heart of what this could really mean. You know, I'm always amazed when this word pondered is used. To ponder is to think about something very, very carefully, especially before making a decision or reaching a conclusion. And in this reading today, I realize that Mary, throughout her life, would have to ponder many things, wouldn't she? For her, this was just the beginning. Consider her life as her son was growing up. She would undergo many ponderings. Soon, she would hear those words from her cousin Elizabeth, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." Think of what was going on through her mind as she would hear the words that her son would speak during his Sermon on the Mount. How proud she would have been. Or about all the miracles he would perform, especially his first miracle that she asked him to do at the wedding of Cana. Or how about people who would react by the way he cured the sick and raised the dead. What was going through her mind then? How about the event she would experience on Palm Sunday as the crowds greeted her son, so enthusiastically, and yet, a week later, she watches the crowds of people shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Or how about the words she would hear her son speak to her from the cross? "Woman, here is your son." And to his disciple, "Here is your mother." How about the words she will hear from her son? "I thirst." Or, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Or it is finished. And then she sees him die in agony on the cross. What's going through her mind then? My friends, I don't know about you, but this chokes me up just hearing these words. And being a parent myself, I could feel Mary's pain just knowing that my child, who was in need, and I could do nothing about it. What ponderings do you have? What ponderings have you had? And what ponderings do you think you might go through for the rest of this life? As we know, throughout Mary's life, she would ponder many things and experience many things like love and pain and grief, much like we all do, all the mothers do, but even more so. But through all this, through all the things that Mary went through, she stood firm and strong, just like our mothers here. This role that the angel Gabriel announced to Mary was one that she did not really ask for, but it was indeed part of God's plan. God had simply stepped into her life and brought her into his service. And she was perplexed, very perplexed. And so we hear Mary's question to the angel Gabriel. How can this be, since I am a virgin? In other words, it didn't make sense to her, but she responded in faith, even though she didn't fully understand. There are times in our lives when we don't fully understand or see what God is going to do, do we? What should our response be? Well, we could respond by saying, I don't completely understand these things, but I do know that God is always good. I will trust what I know to be true of God, even though I'm not sure what he's up to. And like Mary, we should say in faith, Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word. What impossible situations are you facing today, my friends? For some of you, sadly, the holy season will be lonely this year for you, won't it? Some here may be facing a financial crisis that looks hopeless to you right now. Some are out of work and don't have a single lead on a good job. Some here could be looking at a marriage that seems worse, maybe even hopeless. Perhaps you have deep secrets that are eating you up inside. Some of you are estranged from family members. Some have children who are far away from God. And some of you at times feel lonely, and perhaps are far away from God yourselves. What does God want from us? The same thing he wanted from Mary. Simple faith that God will keep his word in unlikely and unexpected ways. He will be there for us. He is there for us. My friends, God is the God of miracles and impossibilities. We all know that. Yes, we will always try to make the best decisions that we can. But you know, we must always be prepared for God to invade our lives by overcoming our impossibilities. And his purpose is to change us from the inside out. And God's miracles are always given, not to bail us out, to get us out of a tight spot, but to change us, as I said, from the inside out. And what does God want in return? Our hearts, our trust, an acceptance that he is our Father, and we can trust him to guide our lives as he sees fit. Nothing is impossible with God. We all know that. And all God wants from us is to let him transform us and change us by accepting that amazing truth. You never know when a miracle from God is coming your way. I think Christmas is all about miracles. Every day is about miracles. And I believe that God surely has great joy in giving us miracles. Sometimes miracles we don't even know that we're getting. God offered Mary a miracle, the greatest ever given, and she accepted. God offers us his miracles as well. And like Mary, may your response always be, "Let it be done to me according to your word." God bless you, my friends. Happy Advent. Merry Christmas. Was that short enough?
We stand together like Mary, with a faith deeply rooted in a God who is faithful. We proudly profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. If we believe that indeed nothing is impossible to God, then with great confidence we make our prayers known to God for this world through the powerful intercession of Mary, our model of faith and hope.
Our response is, "Come, Lord Jesus."
Come, Lord Jesus.
For the pastors and people of the universal community of faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus.
For people with problems who no longer believe that the good news can be for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus.
For the grace of perfect trust in God, like the Virgin of Nazareth, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus.
For our sick and bereaved, especially Anna Castillo, Peter Riley, Duncan Grant, Francis and Jenny Bozo, Tony Petrovich, Nicolina DiPaola, Ann Miles, Mark Wild, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus.
For all the departed who await the reign of Christ that will have no end, especially Teresa Chiamenti, Ron Ryan, Jim Peacock, Mary Lucas, Dorothy Campbell, Adriana Velios, Aaron Iwanchuk, Jude Strickland, Pasquale Bomarito, Emily Rutenbeck, Ken and Claudia Carson, Thora Bujoraz. Let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus.
And at this Mass, we especially pray for Olga Grusuti, and the special intention for Dave and Patty McClung. Let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus. And for all the intentions we verbalize to God from the silence of our hearts. God, our loving Father, as Christmas draws near, we bring these prayers before you. We invoke the intercession of our Blessed Mother, whose faith witnesses to each one of us of what her yes and St. Joseph's yeses should be our yes too, to your ongoing will in our lives. We make these in all prayers through Christ our Messiah.
Amen.
All the world awaits the promise of his birth. Open up the gates, heaven come to earth. A host of angels sing, our Savior here to dwell. The King of every king, our Emmanuel. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to our God. Behold the Son of Man, here in a manger laid. Worthy is the Lamb, for he has come to save. Sin, he freely gave his life, born that we may live, and in him never die. Hosanna,
King Jesus.
Hosanna,
all praise.
Hosanna,
save us.
Hosanna,
he
in the highest, Hosanna. Son of righteousness, light and life to all he brings. Glory to the newborn King. Hosanna, 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 in the highest. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to our God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this bread which we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this wine which we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink. With humble spirit and contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord. May our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. Wash me, O Lord, of my iniquity. Cleanse me of my many sins. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, O Lord, sanctify these gifts laid upon your altar, just as he filled with his power the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For all the oracles of the prophets foretold him. The Virgin Mother longed for him with love beyond all telling. John the Baptist sang of his coming and proclaimed his presence when he came. It is by his gift that already we rejoice at the mystery of his nativity, so that he may find us watchful in prayer and exultant in his praise. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. This Mass, we use Eucharistic prayer number 3. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." My Lord and my God, in a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." My Jesus, mercy. The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one Spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her husband, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint John the Baptist, Saint Catherine of Alexandria, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Gerard, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, the religious, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, we remember especially Olga and the deceased members of this parish family. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sin but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. My brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of God's peace.
Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who by the will of the Father and work of the Holy Spirit, through your death gave life to the world, free us by this your most holy body and blood from all our sins and from all that is evil. Keep us faithful to your commandments, and never let us be parted from you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ bring us all to everlasting life. Amen. May the blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life. Amen. For those at home receiving Jesus in a spiritual communion, I invite you to pray. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
highly favored one, sister in faith, mother of all who believe. Mary, highly favored one, pilgrim of life, message of hope on the way, vision of faith, pray for us now, seeker of truth, lead us to God, bearer of Christ, teach us to be open and free. Mary, image of faithfulness, woman of strength, woman of song, blessed one. Mary, prayerful listening one, disciple of Christ, keeping God's word, holy one. Vision of faith, pray for us now, seeker of truth, lead us to God, bearer of Christ, teach us to be open and free. Mary, bearer of good news, proclaimer of peace, justice and love, voice of the poor, of faith, pray for us now, seeker of truth, lead us to God, bearer of Christ, teach us to be open and free, open and free, open and free.
Did you know
that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb. The sleeping child you're holding is the great I
Let us pray. Having received this pledge of eternal redemption, we pray, Almighty God, that in this feast day of our salvation draws ever nearer, so we may press forward all the more eagerly to the worthy celebration of the mystery of your Son's Nativity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us turn to our Blessed Mother as we pray. We fly to thy protection, O Holy Mother of God. Despise not our petitions and our necessities, but deliver us always from all dangers. O glorious and blessed Virgin, Amen. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in the day of battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl through the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Friends, as I've mentioned for many weeks, if you have not registered for the Christmas Masses, you will be unable to be here. I don't want any trouble for my Catholic bouncers at the door of the church. They are the extension of yours truly. The rules have been set. We must abide by the rules. Many people are worried tomorrow about the Premier's announcement. If we go into red zone, we go into red zone. If we go into lockdown, we go into lockdown. The Lord is in charge. We have nothing to fear. If we go into lockdown or red zone and our numbers are further restricted, then once again, we need to enter into technology, the grace of God who sustains his people even in time of pandemic. Here I am, the servant of the Lord. May it be done unto me according to your word. The Lord moves in our hearts. Do not be afraid, my brothers and sisters. Emmanuel, God is with us. But be actively involved in your faith life. And those receiving my email will receive the further notice once we get it. As you enter the church today, you know the next step that we have to do. Contact tracing. So for now, for the foreseeable future, every time you come to church, you must indicate your envelope number is the easiest way. Then we don't have to write your whole name. For those who don't have envelopes, we need to write your name and phone number. If you refuse to give that to my Catholic bouncers at the door, then you must not enter. That's just the rules. I don't make up the rules. I just work here. Please don't be difficult for my ushers. They tell me what you say to them. Please just say thank you to the Lord for the opportunity to gather. We look forward to the celebration of the Lord's birth, whether it's going to be physical or digital. Whether you are one person or a very large family, Mary's rejoicing was alone. If my rejoicing is alone, so be it. This is not a time to be lonely. This is a time to give honor and praise to God. It doesn't matter about gifts, food, and number of people. What matters is the Lord has come, and he will touch you in a very beautiful and profound way. Let's keep our eyes focused on the Lord and not let the distractions push us from the intention of the one who has come to set us free. My brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration is ended. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Echoes in my soul, I hear the music, and though the storms may come. I am holding on to the rock I am. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives. And I will walk with you, knowing you'll see me the songs you give. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart, I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart, I am loved